Welcome to this NanoSims webinar. This webinar will deal with nitrogen 15 labeling strategy for studying cell origin, aging, and renewal. I am François Auréa. I am the product manager of the NanoSims at Camica, France. We will first use an article focusing on stem cell division. This paper was published in Nature in January 2012 by Matthew Stenhauser, and it's testing the immortal strand hypothesis. So the immortal strand hypothesis predicts that during asymmetric stem cell division, chromosomes containing older template DNA are segregated to the daughter, destined to remain a stem cell, and thus ensuring lifetime genetic stability. So this hypothesis is studied using NanoSims and labeling of the DNA with nitrogen 15 thymidine, mapping the nitrogen 15 over nitrogen 14 ratio. BRDU and IDU replication markers are also used, imaged respectively with bromine and iodine ions. There are a series of progressive steps in the article. The test of DNA labeling of fibroblasts in vitro. Then cell division followed with nuclei labeled with nitrogen 15 thymidine in vitro. Then in vivo on mouse small intestine, nitrogen 15 thymidine incorporation in nuclei of actively dividing crypt cells. Then in the mouse small intestine, cell division quantitation through the dilution of nitrogen 15 thymidine label in nuclei during the label free chase. And finally, the test of the immortal strand hypothesis. On the left side, we see a dividing fibroblast labeled with nitrogen 15 thymidine. It has been sputtered, and we see in DIC the dividing cell. Then we see on the left, on the right side, the nitrogen, so the nitrogen 14 image, and we do not see much contrast, although we have reached the nucleus with sputtering, with ion sputtering. But when we image the ratio nitrogen 15 over nitrogen 14, we can measure the label incorporation in the DNA, in the nucleus, through this label, nitrogen 15 over 14. And we see this ratio is represented in false color. It has reached 8 times the natural abundance ratio in the nucleus. When studies are made with variable concentration, we see a clear increase of the concentration of the label and a very good signal to noise ratio showing or based on an excellent sensitivity of this technique to measure the incorporation of the nitrogen 15 label in the DNA. Now, an in vivo test on mouse small intestine. First, on unlabeled mouse, on small intestinal crypt, we see no contrast in both the nitrogen 15 over nitrogen 14 or the carbon 13 over carbon 12. The images are flat and they can be measured quantitatively at the natural abundance ratio. So this is good. And then in a second step, on mouse administered nitrogen 15 thymidine from postnatal day 4 through 8 weeks, We see no contrast on carbon image, as expected, but a clear contrast in the nitrogen image in the area of nuclei that have incorporated nitrogen 15 during their division from nitrogen 15 thymidine. So nitrogen 15 thymidine incorporation by proliferating small intestinal crypt cells result in an increase, a measurable increase in the nitrogen 15 over nitrogen 14 ratio. Now, a brilliant aspect of this technique on in vivo mouse small intestine. So mice were pulsed 4 hours with nitrogen 15 thymidine, followed by 24-hour chase. When you measure the ratio, you can see three distinct groups of nuclear labeling, high, medium, and lowest. And they are grouped together. The top is a high level of nitrogen 15 label, medium, and lower below. And when you measure, you extract the quantitative data of this ratio, you can see that the high level corresponds to the original labeling. Then for the medium group, the signal, the enrichment is divided by 2 and is divided again by 2 in the third group of cells. So what you can see through this measurement, this quantitative measurement, is that MIMS, this method, can quantitate the cell division cycle through the measurements of the dilution of the thymidine incorporated in the DNA. Based on these capabilities, it is possible to build experiments to test the immortal strand hypothesis. If we start with cells that are fully labeled with nitrogen 15 thymidine. After 2 rounds of replication, if there is a biased segregation, if there is an immortal strand, we should measure quantitatively stem cells still labeled with other not labeled at all. If, in contrary, there is a random segregation, then we should see a random dilution of 50% dilution each round. And a second different experiment can be mounted, starting with mature stem cells, replicating after replication. We should see if this immortal strand hypothesis is valid. We should see the same, some cells unlabeled, totally unlabeled, and some cells keeping the original labeled strand. Or, alternatively, if there is a random segregation, we should see a 50% label dilution. So, in this article, there are many protocols that are applied, and in this webinar we'll just see two of them, and we'll see this in the next slide and in the slide after the next for these two types of experiments. So let's see this first part of developmental labeling to identify label-retaining stem cells. So the experiment is to pulse with nitrogen 15 thymidine mice from day 4 up to 8 weeks after the birth, and then to chase for 4 weeks with normal thymidine, and finally to mark for 1 day, 24 hours, with BRDU to identify the replicating, actively replicating cells. So at the end of the nitrogen 15 labeled thymidine pulse, what can be observed is that on the control unlabeled mice, the entire crypt is at the natural 15, nitrogen 15 abundance level. It's in blue. It's perfectly homogeneous. While the pulsed mouse, in the pulsed mouse case, all nuclei are labeled, more or less depending due to the experiment protocol, but they are all labeled. At the end of the experiment, after the final BRDU labeling, images were recorded, recording from left to right, nitrogen 14 image, phosphorus, nucleic acid, sulfur, bromine to identify the dividing cell, and finally the ratio nitrogen 15 over nitrogen 14. And one can see that apart from some Paneth cells and mesenchymal cells in the bottom of the image and the bottom right side of the image, no other cells reveal nitrogen 15 retention. And if we zoom slightly on part of the script, we confirm this exact observation. So there is no such label retaining stem cells in the small intestinal crypt. So this means we have good probability that this hypothesis of an immortal strand is not right. Let's see the second type of experiment. So in this complementary experiment, adult mouse is a pulse chase to quantitate the dilution of the label. So the experiment is based on adult mice pulsed for 2 weeks at the age of 10 weeks. They are pulsed with nitrogen 15 thymidine. Then finally, a pulse for 1 full day with BRDU to see the dividing cells. And what we see is that the dividing cells indicated in by the bromine high signal, with note the good signal to noise ratio, these dividing cells dilute the nitrogen 15 thymidine labeled relative to the undivided cells, indicated with a large arrow. And if we extract quantitative value from this data, from these images, one can see that the level of enrichment is stable in the non-dividing cells, but in the divided cells, the signal, the enrichment is divided by 2 or divided by 4. Consistent with 1 round of division during the chase or 2 rounds of division. And on the right side, we can see a higher magnification image from a field of view of 10 micron by 10 micron showing segregating chromosomes in mitotic stage in the crypt cell. And they are consistent with symmetric chromosomal segregation. So finally, this second type of experiment indicates random segregation of DNA strands, so a homogeneous dilution of the label. From this rapid overview of this scientific article, one can say that these results and the many others of the article indicate that dividing cells in the crypt uniformly dilute labeled DNA in a pattern consistent with random DNA strand segregation. So the immortal strand hypothesis is infirm. And concerning the methodology or the nanoSIMS instruments, we have seen that the cells can be clearly identified without any staining through the map of CN, phosphorus, and sulfur. The use of nitrogen-15-labeled pyrimidine enabled cell division quantitation through its content in the DNA. The parallel detection of bromine and iodine permits the use of BRDU and IDU replication marker for identifying cells under division. The enrichment map are measured through the division of two maps, one recorded at mass 15 and the second on mass 14. And the nanosims is unique in resolving easily the potential mass interference at each unit mass. For example, carbon 13, nitrogen 14 from carbon 12, nitrogen 15, occurring both at mass 27 AMU. So high mass resolving power while keeping 15 nanometer resolution and very high sensitivity. Let's switch to cardiology. And for this, we will use another paper published in Nature. And this paper is mammalian heart renewal by pre-existing cardiomyocytes, published in Nature in January 2013. So, although studies have revealed that heart cells are generated in adult mammals, the frequency of generation and the source of new heart cells are not yet known. So some studies suggest a high rate of stem cell activity with differentiation of progenitors to cardiomyocytes, but other studies suggest that the new cardiomyocytes are born at a very low rate and that they may be derived from the division of pre-existing cardiomyocytes. So this is the question. This study, based using the nanosims, elucidates this question by combining two different pulse chase approaches, a genetic fate mapping, with stable isotope labeling and multiple isotope imaging mass spec, so MIMS acronym, using nanosims. In the first part of this article, the authors focused on the evolution of DNA synthesis with age. So they recorded maps of nitrogen 15 over nitrogen 14 ratio on newborn or young adult or old adult mice. So the nitrogen 15 pyrimidine was administered for 8 weeks. And what we see are mosaics, but from these mosaics, it's evident that the number of cells that have synthesized new DNA, so incorporating nitrogen 15, is evolving with age. On the right side, we can see a zoom on a young adult cell, cardiomyocyte, where we can see on the left side of the nitrogen 15 enrichment, the nucleus that has been labeled. And at the center, in between, we see two non-cardiomyocytes that have been labeled also. And from these images, we can extract local information, drawing arrow eyes and extracting the ratio, summing the pixel inside these arrow eyes, that show, evidently, with a very good signal-to-noise, the decrease of DNA synthesis with age, between newborn to adult, decrease a lot, and from adult to old, it decreases again. So this is an original method to measure at single cell level the evolution of DNA synthesis. So now let's try to use the nanosim specificity to answer the question, are new cardiomyocytes derived from pre-existing cardiomyocytes or from the division of pre-existing cardiomyocytes? To answer this question, this experiment was built. Transgenic mice treated for 2 weeks with tamoxifen to induce cardiomyocyte-specific GFP expression. Then, these mice were administered nitrogen 15 thymidine continuously during 10-week chase. And so, the purpose is that the cycling cells can be then identified with nitrogen 15 labeling. So, if the cardiomyocytes come from pre-existing cardiomyocytes and a division, they should express GFP at a rate similar to that of the surrounding quiescent cardiomyocytes. So they should appear green. But if the new cardiomyocytes indicated by the label of nitrogen 15, if they are derived from progenitors, they should not appear green. Let's see the experiment. Here's an anatomic image, and at the center of the image, one can see, indicated with a white asterisk, one cardiomyocyte nucleus labeled with nitrogen 15, so cycling cell. And now the question is it coming from a division or a differentiation? And the answer is given by the fluorescence. This cell is evidently GFP plus, hence this new cardiomyocyte is derived from pre-existing cardiomyocytes. And this is in the article repeated on a number of measurements. Now, we'll see in a third article the topic of aging. Let's use the paper from Rafael Arroyo et Trigo et al. In Cell Metabolism in 2019, Age Mosaicism Across Multiple Scales in Adult Tissues. Most neurons are not replaced during an animal's lifetime, and this non-dividing state is characterized by extreme longevity and age-dependent decline of key regulatory proteins. So to study the lifespan of cells and protein in adult tissues, isotope labeling of mice, so stable isotope labeling in mammals, acronym SILAM, was combined with a hybrid imaging method, so nanosims multiple isotope mass spectrometry, coupled with high-resolution secondary electron microscopy, MIMS-EM. This study is based on SILAM, stable isotope metabolic labeling of mammals. So a first phase of nitrogen 15 labeling, so four FVB mouse female were fed nitrogen 15 based spirulina chow starting 45 days postnatal for 10 weeks prior to introducing a male for 1 week. The females were kept on a nitrogen 15 chow diet during mating, gestation, and lactation. Then we get nitrogen 15 labeled pups. Then the second phase, the nitrogen 14 chase, the pups were weaned to normal nitrogen 14 food after 21 or after 45 days postnatal. So after this period, the molecular components, nucleic and amino acids, have been labeled with nitrogen 15 throughout the embryonic development and until the 21st or 45th day of postnatal development. Then the pups were raised on nitrogen 14 food for 6 months, 18 months, or 26 months after the start of the chase. So quite a long period. Then ethanized for preparation and analysis. So during the chase period, when nitrogen 15 labeled cells are replaced by newly synthesized cell, nitrogen 15 is replaced by nitrogen 14. The vast majority of the nuclear nitrogen 15 is expected to stem from nitrogen 15 DNA, and which decreases by 50% after each cell division. So the graphical view of this, we have the nitrogen 15 labeled pups. They go for a long chase of nitrogen 14 food. Now, the mice are ethanized, the tissue are dissected, the central nervous system, the liver, the pancreas are microtomed sectioned, deposited on silicon substrate. They are analyzed with low energy electron microscopy for histology, giving few nanometer resolution. Then the same section are imaged with the Cameca Nanosims 50 to measure the ratio of nitrogen 15 over nitrogen 14. And where the nitrogen 15 ratio is high, it means old cells. When the ratio is low, there is more nitrogen 14, it means it's a new young cell. Correlating electron microscopy and nanosims images is done by first imaging the sections of the tissue with electron microscope, allowing large field of view or mosaic, and allowing to select interesting area. So the EM image allows histological observation with few nanometer resolution. Then we can combine a nanosims map on the same area. And so the EM has a few nanometer resolution, the nanosims has 50 nanometer resolution that we can recognize with this correlative technique, the area and the tissues. If we need a larger field of view nanosims maps, we will use mosaics. For example, this shows a mosaic of 13 by 3 images, small images, because the nanosims is limited to a field of view typically less than 50 by 50 microns. In order to get a very precise superimposition of the images, the nanosims images are first resized to match the pixel size of the SEM, and then they are non-linearly stretched to obtain perfect superimposition of the two types of images. First, the baseline of long-lived cells and structures with CNS cells. So cortical neurons do not divide during adulthood. Thus, the mean nitrogen 15 over nitrogen 14 ratio from random nuclear section of L2 neurons is used as a baseline level for the identification of non-dividing cells. What is observed is that the cells in the inner nuclear layer of the retina and most endothelial cells in the mouse optic nerve and all in the cerebellum are long-lived cells and are as old as neurons, so do not show sign of turnover. So let's see some example. On the left, SEM image has a good resolution showing all the cells structures, and the right, the nanosims image. And if it's in pink, it means a high nitrogen 15 level. So low turnover, so it means an old cell. And with the arrow in yellow at the center, there is one old endothelial cell indicated in pink, as it is high in nitrogen 15. Another example, capillary in the ONH, an old endothelial cell is indicated again with the yellow arrow, so high in nitrogen 15, meaning old and, with a low replacement. So, nevertheless, a few rare young endothelial cell can be detected, like this example, where one can see with the, it's indicated in the yellow asterisk, a young endothelial cell. So it means that turnover of endothelial cells in the brain can happen. So some other example in the central nervous system cells, L2 neuron on top, and old endothelial cell in the bottom of this image. They have been chased for almost 26 months, and they are still very high in the nitrogen 15, showing evidence for their old age. Other example of a close-up of granular cells in the rat cerebellum with old endothelial cell, always indicated by a pink color showing the high ratio of nitrogen 15 over nitrogen 14 cell. So all these data, and there are many more in this article, suggest that lifelong cell persistence extends to non-neuronal cells and is more prominent than previously thought. So these data from these exceptionally long-lived Celam mice provide the first evidence that the neurovascular unit, and more specifically endothelial cells in the brain, are mostly old. However, it also suggests that some vessels are mosaics built of cells with vastly different lifespans. So MIMS-EM combination is a powerful tool to study cellular lifespan. So the same technique of correlative microscopy between electron microscopy and nanosims is applied on liver cell. So liver has a high regenerative capacity. On P45 mouse chased nitrogen 14 for 6 months or 18 months. So here we see the images of the 6 month mouse, and below we see the image of the 18 months mouse, or mouse after 18 months of chase. And what one can see, for example, on the hepatocyte, that between 6 months and 18 months animal, there is an increase, a progressive increase of young cells. But most hepatocytes and cholangiocytes are as old as neurons. And when we compare with sinusoid endothelial cells, we see a striking difference between 6 months and 18 months. We see a marked increase of young cells between 6 and 18 months. So most capillary endothelial cells in hepatic sinusoids and most stellar cells undergo a major turnover event between 6 and 18 months of life. So this data suggests that the aging liver has a tissue architecture characterized by an intercellular age mosaicism. So Now, imaging in the pancreas, images on the islets of Langerhans, one can see the electron microscope image on the left, allowing histology, the nanosims mapping on the right, showing the age. So if it's pink, it's old because it's still rich in nitrogen 15. If it's blue at terrestrial level, it's very young. So we see, for example, in the SEM image on the left, lower side, we see two cells, one old acinar cell in pink arrow, and it appears in pink color, and a young acinar cell near the middle, the bottom of the image, which is blue, meaning it's white. Other type of extract, here we just see a zoom of the small box C of this upper image, and we see beta cells in yellow and an old alpha cell in pink, showed by its high nitrogen 15 ratio. On the image, the couple of image D, an old delta cell on the left is so in pink, is next to a younger beta cell, top right, with in average a lower level of nitrogen 15. On the image couple E, young and old endothelial cell are shown in the field of view. An old pancreatic stellate cell are seen in the top and lower right corners. Always the same, old, more towards the pink color. Now, what is interesting is that individually, for each type of cells, here the author show five types of different cells, it is possible to see their evolution between the different lengths of chasing. The lowest row is 18 months of chase, and the upper row is 26 months of chase. And depending on the cell types, there is a huge difference of change on their relative turnovers. So that's a unique technique to be able to measure this at single cell level. So together, this data indicate that the islet of Langerhans is a mosaic composed of cells with vastly different lifespan, where most alpha and beta cells assume a quiescent and long-lived cell phenotype between weaning, 25 days, and the first month of adult life. Moreover, it suggests that proliferation of alpha and beta cells is not uniform throughout adulthood, contrary to what earlier studies have indicated. So at this step, the researchers went one step further to the protein level or sub-structure level. What you see here are S secondary electron images recorded on two sections of beta cell primary cilium from a mouse chased for 26 months with nitrogen 14. So above these images where is superimposed in green and blue, the nanosims images of the nitrogen 15 over 14 ratio. And what you see is that the basal body of beta cells, primary cilium, contain high nitrogen 15, so meaning old, while the rest of the cilium has been replaced by new components. Then, from a L2 neuron, from a mouse chased 6 months, Similarly, on serial sections, so at different, progressively different depths of the neuron, basal body, and the primary cilium, the similar nanosims images of the ratio are superimposed to the high resolution SEM, showing a local ratio of the nitrogen 15. High level, but also what is remarkable is a different level of ratio. So meaning that there is an evidence of protein age mosaicism without one single subcellular structure, while suggesting that long-lived structures are present in the primary cilium and that their turnover could be different in beta cells and neurons. So the output of this article, combining high-resolution electron microscopy and isotopic ratio with the nanosims, are that liver and pancreas are composed of cells with vastly different ages, many as old as the animal. A subset of fibroblasts and endothelial cells, both known for their replicative potential, are characterized by their absence of cell division during adulthood. And in addition, the primary cilia or beta cell and neurons contain different structural regions with vastly different lifespans. And based on this result, the authors propose that age mosaicism across multiple scales is a fundamental principle of adult tissue, cell, and protein complex organization. So we have seen in this webinar the potential of using stable isotope labeling, namely here nitrogen 15, together with isotopic ratio mapping performed with the nanosims. The nanosims is an original ion microprobe combining simultaneously 50 nanometer lateral resolution, parallel detection of 7 masses, high sensitivity, and high mass resolving power. The strategy of using one or several stable isotope labeling, because one can use several labels in parallel, enables mapping the distribution and measuring quantitatively the accumulation or loss or turnover or fluxes of labeled molecule at intracellular level or at tissue level. Electron microscopy enables intracellular structure identification with few nanometer lateral resolution, while nanosims isotopic mapping of labeled molecules enables the quantitative measurements of the labeled fluxes with 50 nanometer resolution. So their correlative use results in a powerful and innovative approach, opening new fields of studies in life sciences. Thank you very much.